Welcome to the 2015 Indo-American Community Lecture at UC Berkeley, delivered by Dr. Nivedita Menon. We're quite delighted. My name is Lawrence Cohen. I'm the director of the Institute for South Asia Studies here. This lectureship is particularly important to students and faculty across this university, not only because of the many illustrious scholars from India who have held it, but as it's a precious gift from the Indo-American community to this university and to the values of reasoned and critical conversation and research for which it stands. This generosity sustains the university and our center. So I want to begin by thanking the community for the vision as well as the material support for this, for the dogged work of research and for the understanding and innovation that this sustains. It's also notable for the key role that the Consulate General of India played, working closely with my predecessor, Bob Goldman, to bring this lectureship into being. And as faculty, we're grateful for this relationship, and we hope it will continue. It's a great personal delight that Dr. Menon is here. Many of you may know her not only as one of the most prominent political theorists, writing both on questions in India and the world, and feminist scholars and theorists, but also as an extraordinarily powerful public intellectual through many, many sites and media, not the least of which is the very well-known website, which she is at the center of creating and continually reimagining, kafila.org. And her writing really works across multiple genres, including, and I didn't realize as much as fully until today, as not only a theorist of questions of translation, and she gave today a workshop with graduate students on questions of translation, but actually as a translator. I'll come back to that. Dr. Menon is the author of many books. For I first encountered her through an edited volume, Gender and Politics in India, but particularly through a widely engaged book called Recovering Subversion, Feminist Politics Beyond the Law, in 2004, and a line of thinking, innumerable articles and interventions, leading up to the recent 2012 Seeing Like a Feminist. She has many edited volumes, co-authored works, and she also, as I noted, has translated, and translated in many different ways, from Malayalam and from Hindi into English, both fiction and non-fiction, and from Malayalam into Hindi. And she's also been thinking a lot about the context and conditions in which such translations circulate, and how her most recent translation into English is Gitanjali Shree's Hindi novel, Khalid Jaga, in 2011. It's a particular honor that she's could come to Berkeley. We're very grateful, and we look forward to today's lecture. Dr. Menon.
Thank you so very much, and thank you to the Institute of South Asia Studies for inviting me, and to all the people here, Lawrence, Pranita, Sanchita, and Manali, for their extraordinary generosity and efficiency. And thank you to so many of you who have had made the time to have conversations with me. Every conversation has been special, and I've gone back and made little notes immediately after meeting you. So thank you very much. Berkeley's been a very warm and exciting place for me in the 3 days that I've been here. Meanwhile, my paper has got stuck in the folder. Okay, Pranita, you're designing. Okay, done. Thank you. I didn't realize it was a mistake. So thank you for this opportunity, really, to present before you work which is really very new. I can barely even call it work yet. So this is really the first presentation of an argument which I hope would be the beginning of a larger work. So, as you know, the title is Women's Rights to Land and the Challenge of the Commons, and bringing women into the ambit of individual property rights, as we all know, has long been one of the key issues for feminist practice and scholarship. So that's something I'm going to take for granted, that we know this. So this is part of a larger work on feminism and property, I hope, that will reflect on the idea of the individual, possession and ownership across intellectual and political traditions. That would be the project, as I think it might eventually become in 5 years, or not. So I don't want anyone sending me emails saying, so have you done it yet? I hope that's the shape it will take. Here I'm going to focus on land ownership and the growing recognition that in the face of large-scale land acquisitions for corporate global capital across the globe, the real challenge to capitalist ambitions is posed by collective ownership of land and strong assertions of the commons. So today I will attempt to think through what this recognition would mean for feminist understandings of land rights for women, drawing today largely on the Indian experience, although the larger project hopes to take on board these issues as they play out in Africa, Latin America, and with movements of indigenous people globally. This means that I am setting aside for the moment, as undisputed from a feminist perspective, the rights of women to non-landed property in natal and matrimonial families, to the matrimonial home, to maintenance upon divorce. I'm not going to touch upon or think about non-landed property in this paper, but I'm very open to being challenged about it in the discussion. I think what is happening is that at this moment in time, several kinds of political movements and several strands of scholarship from the end of the 20th century onwards, for about three decades or so, are coming together to alert us to a need for a shift in feminist perspective on land rights for women. Let me begin with what we hear from struggles against the accelerated and large-scale acquisitions by the state for use by private corporations. Activists in these movements and scholars engaged in understanding land relations are increasingly coming to the recognition that the state is now very amenable to what are called joint pattas, that is, title deeds, joint title deeds for the husband and wife to family land. This has been a very old demand of women's movement for decades. But what is actually happening at the beginning of the 21st century is that when you listen to what land rights activists are saying, they are actually saying that the state is very amenable to joint pattas. And they note the trend to restrict farmers to family plots by giving them formal title deeds, even joint pattas, while the state takes over common and public lands. Enclosures, evictions, and land use policies are all state strategies for taking over common and public lands. And of course, when that happens, title deeds are no magic potion against land acquisition. Rather, individual title deeds facilitate land acquisitions by the state. Furthermore, it has long been understood in the context of land reforms that joint patta, in effect, sidelines the question of land distribution, and in that sense, is not a radical agenda. We will return to these issues that I flag here later. But in the meanwhile, let's listen to Roma, an activist with All India Union of Forest Working People, who now states publicly that the forest people's movement is opposed to the patta as such. Now these are, if for those who have been following with the women's movement and feminist demands and these movements in South Asia, this is an extraordinary position to take for an activist to say we're opposed to the patta as such, which she sees as looking at land use and ownership exclusively through the prism of the family. In her experience, she says, only collective ownership can fracture patriarchy, and her organization works with movements that collectively cultivate land. Such a movement would be a movement of the landless, not of middle and upper peasantry. So there is thus, in this kind of understanding, a contradiction between the interests of peasants and the landless, this we know, who use common lands, but also a belief in an alliance of marginal farmers and landless as necessary to bridge the caste divide, as of course the landless would largely be Dalits. Common lands that embody layers of customary usufructory rights are the biggest impediment to market relations, and prime among such lands are forests. It is in this context that land occupation movements by castes and tribes traditionally excluded from agriculture must be viewed and understood. For example, the occupation of Mutana forest lands in Kerala by Adivasis, violently evacuated by the police in 2005. C.K. Janu, chairperson of the Adivasi Gotra Mahasabha that spearheaded this struggle, said in an interview, "Adivasis are the real owners of land. Our main slogan is the right to live in the land where we are born until death." This occupation of lands by the poor is in fact a reoccupation of common lands, which were turned into state-owned land overnight through colonial legislation such as the Indian Forest Acts of 1878 and 1927, and of course carried on and enforced by the post-independence Indian state as well. So what we're seeing is globally the trend is towards the legitimation by states and World Bank institutions of property titles for the poor and for women. Even as these states and institutions engage in large-scale land acquisition in the interests of what James Petrus calls extractive capital. Is there a disjuncture between women's individual rights to land and struggles to protect or create a commons? It seems that something completely counterintuitive with regard to feminist common sense is being articulated in these contexts. Now, what I'm going to do is very quickly map the three kinds of access to land rights in India, and in the way that I map these three spaces, I hope to show that the emergence of what is happening with the emergence of individual property rights. So there are three kinds of access to land rights in India: through religious personal laws to agricultural land, through forest acts to forests. Now, when I say access, it also means lack of access. So through forest acts to forests, and through customary laws to both agricultural and forest lands, to groups that are classified as tribes. So I will just very briefly map women's rights and the emergence of women's rights in each of these spaces in turn. The question really that we need to address, so when we look at women's rights through personal laws, which is what I will begin with, where most transformations have taken place, the question that we need to address is, why is the Indian state so amenable to joint pattas by the early 21st century? Why are women's rights to land now recognizably centrally located in the national policy agenda? After all, Bina Agarwal, whose work is extraordinary work in mapping women's access to land, she has argued for over a decade and a half for women's independent rights in land on grounds of welfare, efficiency, equality, and empowerment, and has pointed out that it has been easier to push the welfare and efficiency arguments with state planners than equality and empowerment of women. The former are more easily understood, she says, within a poverty alleviation framework, while the latter, she sees, that is, arguments about equality and empowerment of women, run counter to what she calls deep-rooted notions of appropriate gender relations shared by many men who make and implement policy, for whom more equal gender relations appear as threatening to existing family and kinship structures. Certainly nothing leads us to think that these attitudes have changed. On the contrary, policymakers continue to express the most appallingly sexist and misogynist opinions quite freely and publicly. And yet, the Hindu Succession Amendment Act, which amends Clause 6 and omits Clause 4.2 of the Hindu Succession Act of 1956 to give women rights to ancestral property, was declared passed unanimously in the Rajya Sabha in August 2005, and then unanimously in the Lok Sabha later in the same year. Several states had already passed such legislation between 1986 and 1994, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and so on, while Kerala abolished the joint family altogether in 1975. What did this Hindu Succession Act Amendment Act of 2005 accomplish? Bina Agarwal calls it path-breaking, which it is, because it establishes gender equality on agricultural land and in co-pastorally joint family property. So women now have succession rights to co-pastorally joint family property, even to husbands' co-pastorally joint family property. Now, when you look at the debates, it was unanimously passed. So if you look at the debate in the Lok Sabha during the passing of this act, several interesting things emerged. For one, you find that several MPs who supported the amendment demanded that it be extended to include agricultural land, which if you've read the amendment, you know that it is already proposed by it. So they're demanding something which is already in the amendment. That is the degree of attention they are paying to the amendment that they're debating in the Lok Sabha, unanimously passed, mind you. So I'm actually not pointing out that they are just disinterested. I'm not saying that. I'm actually suggesting something more, that there is an ultimate passing of the act despite the debate, which I find very fascinating. So you have this. The debate in the Lok Sabha is intriguing, partly because of the enthusiastic support from many MPs who had clearly not read the proposed amendments with any care. That is, they're welcoming the bill and they're saying, but it should also be extended to, some of them, should also be extended to agricultural land. But even more so, because several MPs had extremely negative responses to the bill, and anyone who has looked at the debates on the Hindu Succession Act in 1956, the debates at that time, exactly the same arguments are being made again in 2005 by several MPs. So, well, across party lines. So you have Shailendra Kumar of the Samajwadi Party, who attacks the UPA for playing the politics of women's vote bank, and he ties together the Domestic Violence Act, which was also just passed, women's reservations, and he accuses the UPA of playing the politics of women's vote bank. And he said that instead of giving women equal rights to property in their native home, they should instead be educated and self-reliant, ideally not getting women to our property. But after marriage, they're anyway fully entitled to the right of property in the in-laws' home, and this bill will create wide gulfs in a family, especially between brother and sister. Raja Rampal, a communist MP, this was a UPA government, of course, proposing the bill, and said these measures would further diminish the size of cultivable land, which is a very old argument against land rights for women, which Dina Agarwal, among others, has dealt with conclusively in her work through both empirical evidence as well as the argument that fragmentation of land would never be used as an excuse to deny land rights to many sons. Mehtab of Janata Dal began by giving illustrations of why the legislation did not go far enough, but then he turns around to criticize the bill because it increases inequalities among women in the family, which is an anomaly that Dina Agarwal points out, except that she suggests that it be redressed, and he suggests that that's the reason why it should not be passed. And interestingly, he says it will encourage female feticide. This is a term that, so the existence of land property rights for women will encourage female feticide. Kishan Singh Sangwan of BJP feared deterioration in social structure through litigation and families, and characteristically, because he's from the BJP, he added that the law should be applicable to Christian and Muslim women also. Apparently unaware that the Shariat law already gives property rights to women and a Christian person law had already been amended. He also added that female feticide might increase. Samajwadi Party, Tufani Saroj, said our social fabric would be ruined. Only physically challenged women and girls who cannot get married should get this right. Now, these are the views. I'm just giving you some of the views. Now, despite these kind of views being expressed across party lines, however, the bill was unanimously passed in the Lok Sabha. Earlier, when the bill was discussed in the Rajya Sabha, it was reported, I quote from a newspaper, only one male member, the rest were women, participated in the discussion that came at the fag end of the day. Some of the members pointed to the low attendance in the house during the debate, unquote. But there too, the bill was unanimously passed, and the Minister for Law, Bharadwaj, expressed happiness at the unequivocal support given to the bill by the BJP-led opposition NDA. In other words, the debate in the Lok Sabha reflects on the part of many MPs the same deep-rooted notions of gender inequality that Agarwal noted, and many seem to be unaware of even the basic provisions of the bill. In the Rajya Sabha, it seems not even to have attracted sufficient interest to produce a debate, and yet the bill was unanimously passed. We need to ask ourselves, therefore, what the transformation is that is being brought about in the name of equal rights for women. Let us go back to about a century ago to seek some answers. And in this section, I'm going to look at the ways in which modern regimes of property get established under colonialism, but by looking at some interesting new work, very interesting historical work, which is now emerging on Hindu law reform and codification in late colonial India. A process that has hitherto been debated in feminist scholarship in terms of enhancement or curtailing of women's rights to property. Now, when you look at this work, and in this, for the purpose of this talk, I'm looking at Ritu Birla's work and Elena Newbigin's work, there is this body of work that is enabling a reframing of this codification as, Ritu Birla puts it, the making of capitalist subjects. In her study in the Indian Chamber of Commerce, Birla shows how parts of this are in quotes, I won't keep saying quote unquote, but Birla basically shows how vernacular capitalists take to place in the colonial global through the gender production of the local, especially in defense of the joint family system. She traces the complicated history of the Hindu undivided family as an alibi for the family form. This is her phrase. Colonial commercial law of partnership sought aggressively to place the HUF, the Hindu undivided family, under the purview of contract in response to complaints of British traders regarding the unenforceability of contracts with indigenous firms. I quote Rituna, the constitution of native firms shifted depending on the birth of sons within joint families and the marriage of daughters into other families. This fluidity allowed the management of debt and transfer of capital between retail, wholesale and money lending concerns. British traders worried that native firms' familial structure helped them to evade contractual obligations. One kind of response to the imposition of colonial commercial law of partnership was from Gujarati, from Gujarati traders was to validate kinship-based capitalism through a defense of the HUF, representing it as a perfectly legitimate form of commercial organization. Through this intervention, they challenged the modern common sense, solidly normalized through colonial law, that commerce as a public endeavor and family expressed as authority over women and children were mutually exclusive. Rather, they sought to produce the joint family as a codified, therefore modern, and not customary, therefore traditional arrangement. Colonial response was then to treat the HUF as an analogous to the joint stock company through the Super Tax Act of 1917, but to tax the HUF at source while joint stock companies could deduct amounts paid to individual members or shareholders. So this, what Ritu calls this strange creature of the bazaar, the family firm, was at the center of competing intra-community discourses of social reform, which held that the ethical management of the joint family would be consistent with material development. So this was the social reform position, that the ethical management of the joint family is consistent with material development. And orthodoxy, which held that the joint family was a realm of Hindu culture, separate from public material concerns. So this codified legal creature, the HUF, shielded the jointness and fluidity of kinship-based commerce. What I'm finding interesting when I read Ritu's work is that there's an interesting way in which this kind of work, of course it's new, but in any case, this kind of work rarely enters feminist scholarship. Feminist scholarship rarely enters historical work around. So in a way, I'm hoping that by producing all of this work in one space, there is a way in which feminist scholarship would need to rethink how we have thought about property rights for women. So for example, there's a very interesting set of debates over the proposed amendments to the Special Marriage Act of 1872 that Rita outlines, which are productive for feminist thinking on this, rethinking on this legislation, which, like other legislations on family and marriage, has tended to be read as reflecting debates on the status of women. Now, this 1872 Act was inspired by Henry Maine's proposals to remove caste disabilities and provided for civil marriage for those who profess no religion. But since the Privy Council had declared that Hindus could not renounce their religion and that Buddhist, Jains and Sikhs counted as Hindus for the purposes of succession and marriage, an amendment was proposed in 1921 to permit civil marriage for those professing these other faiths. Orthodox opinion, of course, reacted strongly to recognizing contractual forms of marriage as Hindu, because they said Hindu marriage is a sacrament. But reformist voices within commercial castes, like the Marwaris, tried to support marriage reform while keeping co-pastoral property relations outside their purview. So what is really happening is that all these debates around marriage are about protecting the Hindu undivided family from the incursions of British commercial law. But at the same time, within these communities, Ritu shows, there is a voice which is pro-reform, which is really about reforming the conditions of business to enter into modern capitalist relations. It's played out in the bodies of women, it's talked about as if it were about control over women. But what is really happening is that it is an attempt to either protect older forms of doing trade and commerce, which are not compatible with modern capitalism, and then you have the emerging elites which want to bring about certain reforms which are compatible with modern capitalism. So you find that reformist voices within commercial castes like the Marwaris strive to support marriage reform while keeping co-custody property relations outside their purview. So conservatives sought HUF's autonomy from public regulations. Social reformists attempted to align its patriarchy with the aims of the code word is national progress, which is really about building modern capitalist relationships. So the discourse that circulates is that of social reform, but it is clear from this account that the reforms are about creating modern entities amenable to capitalist economic arrangements while accommodating the tension between the order of state and family. Now, the focus on Hindu law here, why I'm focusing on Hindu law, is largely because through law reforms of the 1860s, colonial officials both created and formalized personal laws, the effect of which was different on Muslim and Hindu personal law. So Quranic Shariat law was presented as traditional, but as well as clear-cut and easily applied. And in fact, the argument at that time, as Elena Newbegin demonstrates, was that under the Shariat, Muslim laws, Muslim families are already composed of property-owning individuals, whereas the natural condition of the Hindu family was joined. So in fact, if you look at the 1920s, the debate, the arguments are exactly the opposite of the way in which Hindu nationalists present the argument. Now, it is Hindu law that is being seen as backward, unable to enter capitalist relations properly because they are joined, they are not individual property owners. Muslim law has already been modernized. It's already composed of property-owning individuals. So it was actually Hindu laws that were considered as requiring reform to bring them into the modern world of individual rights to property. The impetus towards reform came, argues Elena Newbegin, from conflicts between Hindu professional and mercantile elites on the one hand and agrarian elites on the other, putting pressure on the Mitakshara Upasanari and its system of joint intergenerational property ownership, through which agrarian elites maintain their authority, while Indian merchants competing with European capital, this focus on joint rights was problematic. Of course, both groups were found in the same families, and younger men gradually opposed joint family living and collective property ownership in the emerging Anglo-Hindu law. One could look at the movement towards the legal abolition of matrimony in Kerala as part of the same process. If you look at other scholars who have looked at it, Pravina Kodot, for example, G. Arunima, what we actually see is that the last vestiges of Naya matrilineal that had gradually been delegitimized were finally removed with the Hindu Succession Act of 1956. And Praveena Kodal has pointed out that this dispossession of women was produced within a narrative of historical progress and the newly emerging discourse of individual rights. That is, the end of Naya women's exclusive rights to native property under matrilineal was conducted impeccably in the language of rights, pitting the rights of the wife against those of the sister of the Naya man, who was, of course, the subject of rights was never assumed to be the Naya woman herself. Now, there's a very interesting bill which does not get passed, which Elena Newbegin draws our attention to, which is in the Madras Assembly in 1915, Divan Bahadur Ramchandra Rao, clearly a far-sighted person ahead of his times, he introduced a bill to facilitate partitioning of co-pastory estates and to grant women absolute ownership of property inherited from their husbands. On the explicit argument that this would, he said, improve market relations and produce a more streamlined legal system. This was opposed at that time by powerful landed elites and never passed. But 15 years later, there's the Hindu Games of Learning Bill in 1930, drafted by Jayakar, which did pass. Now, this legislation is not about women's rights to land, and but to income. And it is illustrative of the manner in which the figure of women and their rights get mobilized into larger processes by which commercial elites gain ascendancy over traditional patriarchs. So although it's not strictly within the focus of this paper, let me take a minute to consider it. This legislation, the Hindu Gains of Learning Bill, was attempting to make income earned by a son as a result of an English education his sole individual property, that is, professional Hindu men, overriding the principles of the Mitakshara Kopasari, in which income earned from a profession was to revert to the joint family. Now, why was this necessary? How was this bill justified? How was it presented? It is vital for improving the position of Hindu women, as widows could through it inherit their husband's self-earned income and avoid a life of destitution. Jayakar also argued, implying that the Muslim community was not hindered in the same way, that joint family ownership undermined entrepreneurial drive and easy access to credit. There were two achievements of this bill in New Begins Reading. One, it secured the economic and domestic power of the male Hindu commercial classes over the older patriarchs or kartas, over the Hindu family. Two, it enabled British finance officials during the economic depression to expand the tax base, overriding attempts by Hindu professionals to include their salaries as part of the joint family tax return. I never thought, till I read Ellen Newbegin, that income tax laws could be so fascinating. it's a brilliant work. I urge you all to look at it. It's like reading a detective novel. Either that says something about me or something about the book. I like to think it's the brilliance of Eleanor's work. The Hindu Gains of Learning Act thus intended supposedly to give widows a means of subsistence. What it does is it produces this individual Hindu man with an individual income who can be taxed, but it also is producing individual rights to property. It's producing a regime of bourgeois. It's producing a proper bourgeois regime of property. Meanwhile, it had come to be generally accepted that under Shariat law, daughters could inherit from their fathers and had rights to divorce and maintenance, and so it was more progressive and modern than Hindu laws. Hindu men, interested therefore in producing the idea of an all-India Hindu community with similar progressive laws, came together. And G.D. Deshmukh introduced Hindu Married Women's Rights to Property Bill in 1937, the same year as the Shariat Act, including the widow and the daughter and the list of heirs, to succeed absolutely to a Hindu man's property. There was opposition from those in northern India, but this is all Eleanor's work, while from the west and south there was more willingness to contemplate radical reform. Ultimately, the law was redrafted along more conservative lines, excluding daughters and giving rights only to widows. Now, obviously, and I'll just quickly say this before I move on, that these developments cannot be seen independently of the longer process of turning land into a commodity, which had begun in 1793 with the permanent settlement, culminated in the Land Acquisition Act of 1894, the process through which what John G. Kuhar calls the rule of property was sought to be established over heterogeneous practices of land use and land relations, basically creating precise and definitive saleable property rights. So one has to read these other developments in that context. When we turn to the modern independent nation state and the modernizing of property, one very interesting legislation is the First Amendment to the Constitution in 1951, in which the right to agrarian property was significantly limited by amendments to Article 31, through which state acquisition of land could no longer be challenged on grounds of inadequate compensation. This was meant for land reforms. And the ninth schedule was created in which land reform legislation was to be placed, protecting it from judicial review. Now, it's another whole interesting debate, but I'm just going to look at, very briefly, touch upon the fact that when you look at the debate on this, and when you look at the way these reforms are talked about, it is very clear these reforms were not meant to weaken property rights as such, only landed property in feudal estates. So, for example, T.T. Krishnamachari, in a letter to Nehru written in 1954 later, during discussions of the Fourth Amendment, said, "We have to move to the left on agricultural land, but moving left in industry will prevent expansion." In the debate on the First Amendment in 51, Hussain Imam, this is one interesting point that I wish to place before you, a Zamindar MP from Bihar, protesting the lack of fairness and uniformity in compensation, demanded that not only feudal forms of property should be targeted. He said, "Whatever the law you may pass, it must not be for Zamindari alone, but for all kinds of property. Property must not be sacrosanct when it is held by black marketeers and industrialists, and taken without compensation when held by simple Zamindars or villagers." In a sharp retort reflecting modern capitalist notions of property, Pandit Krishnachand Sharma put him in his place by saying, "The other property, that is, the black marketeers and industrialists, the other property a man creates, land you have not created." It is significant that no voice in Parliament explicitly opposed the abolition of Zamindari. The debate was over whether compensation should be just or adequate. So what you see is the fledgling bourgeois state putting into place notions of legitimate and illegitimate property. You have the Hindu Marriage Act of 55 and the Hindu Succession Act of 1956, far-reaching changes were brought about. These are normally presented as reform of Hindu laws to give women equal rights to property. I won't go into this because this is not the focus of my talk here, except to show that there is a way in which through these amendments, property rights for women expand, individual property rights expand. But it's a very halting process. So if you look at the work of Flavia Agnes and the very early work of Madhukishwar, you see that when you look at these acts, what they really did was that it codified, it did not really reform, and the codification was along lines which basically brought heterogeneous practices in line with upper caste North Indian practices. In the process, it took away actually many rights that women had under other communities. That's a whole other, I mean, we could come back to this, but so there was a kind of break on the process. What should have happened in 55 and 56 did not happen. That is the complete creation of individual property rights across the board, including for women. Now, I have argued in earlier work that when you look at these debates on, when you look at what is happening with personal laws on succession and property, it would be a mistake, and I think feminists have tended to make this mistake, it would be a mistake to see these as the patriarchal state, as if the imperatives of patriarchy and the modern state are the same. In fact, when you look at the way, the stuttering way in which individual property rights emerge in Hindu personal laws, you can actually see that this is a point of conflict between the imperatives of the state and those of the family, which by 2005, that conflict is sorted out. But this is the argument, this point of conflict between the imperatives of the state and those of the family. That is the argument I'm actually trying to explore more fully in this paper. The modern state requires legibility in order to mobilize resources towards capitalist industrialization. That is, it must be able to see and recognize forms of property in existence. And towards this end, the institution of individual rights to property is crucial. All forms of property must become completely available and transparent to the state. The family, on the other hand, has its own imperatives of controlling name, descent, the patriarchal family, name, descent, and passing on of property, a project disrupted by individual property rights. However, the desire to modernize and to set up such a regime of property rights is also present within sections of the community, leading to debates between progressives, so-called progressives, and so-called conservatives. In the light of this understanding, we must view the gradual granting of property rights to women under Hindu law as more than a simple triumph of some kind of feminist worldview. It also represents the final or the coming into being of a proper capitalist regime of property for the Hindu community, at least in principle, which makes land completely alienable by every separate individual owner. In the current climate of widespread resistance to land acquisition, this is a considerable achievement for the state and for capitalist interests within the community, as it's always easier to pressurize or tempt individual owners rather than communities to sell land. I will come back to 2005 and something else that happened in 2005 towards the latter bit of my paper. But 2005 is, of course, the point at which it finally happens. Turning now to forest lands and customary land rights, which have different histories. Looking at forests very quickly, Sumit Sarkar in modern times shows that prior to what he terms the environmental turn in history writing, rural India was assumed to consist of a multitude of peasant villagers engaged in settled agriculture. Extending cultivation to cultivable waste was seen as synonymous with the advance of civilization. Environmental histories brought about a paradigm shift in this understanding, demonstrating that hunters and gatherers, pastoralists, and those who practiced shifting cultivation were not just extremely significant, they were significant and they were far from marginal until regulatory mechanisms of the state started drawing in on them in the late 19th century. Through the Forest Acts of 1865 and 1878, the Forest Department came to control one-fifth of British Indian land area. And overnight, communities that had lived for generations in forests became encroachers on newly enclosed forest lands, and their everyday subsistence activities became crimes. Cattle grazing and cutting low-hanging branches, gathering leaves, and so on. And so you have a series of legislations all the way up to 1927, which basically remained the main legal basis for depriving forest dwellers of their user rights to forest resources. Now, there were two main purposes behind these moves: developing forests for the modern timber industry through scientific forestry, and expanding arable farming at the cost of nomadic communities of pastoralists and hunter foragers for the extraction of land revenue and enhancing of export surplus. Now, this process of encouraging sedentarization was in continuation of land revenue policy since the 18th century, which we've talked to already, and those who refused to settle down were branded as vagrants and criminals. Now, this process has carried on apace in independent India with the National Forest Policy of 1952, which focused on protecting forest resources while commercially exploiting minor forest produce. You have the Forest Conservation Act of 1980, which placed all forests under the control of the central government. In addition to this kind of legislation, the Supreme Court has now integrated in two Indian environmental jurisprudence the idea of the state as trustee of all natural resources, which is in international law, it is produced as a progressive development which protects the environment. That is when the state is the trustee of all natural resources. But essentially what we really see is that this marks a shift in state policy from the colonial objective of encouraging sedentarization to dispossessing forest dwellers, so that forests can be handed over to private interests for more efficient extraction of forest produce. So it's interesting that much of these developments are actually produced in the literature, in whatever literature is relevant, as progressive and good for the environment. During the UPA regime, movements of forest people supported by left parties in parliament were able to get past the Scheduled Tribes Recognition of Forest Rights Act of 2006, which is called the Forest Rights Act of 2006. This act tried to do was, and it did, because it had so much input from movements, including the forest, the Roma's organization that I talked about, and left parties and other movements. This legislation was actually interesting because it was brought about in order to recognize and formally codify some rights for forest dwellers. But interestingly, the rights that are sought to be recorded are not only individual rights to cultivated land in forest landscapes, but collective rights to control, manage, and use forests and its resources as common property. It also stipulates the conditions for relocation of forest dwellers from critical wildlife habitations, but only with their informed consent and their rehabilitation in alternative land. So it's clear that through the involvement of forest people's movements, it's not some kind of traditional rights that are being asserted, it is not individual rights that are being asserted, but new forms of collective rights and claims are being fashioned. Now, collective rights are of course not desirable from the point of view of either the forest department, which has set up patronage networks through bribery and so on, nor for supporters of corporate investment-based development. The provision of in the FRA of 2006, making it mandatory to take prior informed consent of village ground sabhas for any diversion of forest land, is also an obstacle to corporate exploitation of forests. So it's not surprising that within 100 days of the Modi government, the Ministry of Environment and Forests passed 240 of 325 projects held up for lack of environmental clearance. And it emerged that the government was planning to completely bypass FRA provisions by using the provisions of another act, an earlier act, Environment Protection Act, which only requires a public hearing for giving permission to any project and not the informed consent of individual ground sabhas. Now, this obviously undermines the Gram Sabha, but also establishes the dominance of bureaucrats and experts and politicians on decisions of diversion of forest land. So this FRA of 2006 that emerged from movements and has enormous potential for rejuvenating forests and the collective livelihoods of forest people can be a threat to expanded regimes of individual property rights amenable to capital, and is not surprisingly under huge threat under the new corporate friendly regime. When we look at customary laws is a term used to refer to bodies of unwritten usages that govern the lives of communities called tribes in northeastern central India. Tribes consider these as intrinsic to their identity, culture, and tradition, but of course they have not remained unchanged through time. So although the colonial government formally did not intervene in customary practices, it said it did not intervene, but it did intervene extensively. So for example, it created the office of a village leader or Gaon Gora, which is a completely colonial invention. and that ran counter to the traditional chief. There were legislations of 1838 and 1886 which facilitated land acquisition. So there's a way in which, as we know, British colonialism functioned, where it said it is not intervening, but it intervened in order not to intervene. Now, when you look at the customary laws across Central and the North India and the Northeast, the land tenure system is not uniform. There are some tribes have complete community-based ownership, others combine individual with clan ownership. So I won't obviously go into all the different kinds of patterns that are there, but the argument is made again and again, among others by Amita Babiskar, who's what some of you will be familiar with, that practices of community ownership are basic to intra and intergenerational equity, as well as the relatively high status of women. Because even individually owned land was treated as community resource inherited from ancestors. So the argument is not some kind of romanticized tribal societies are free from gender hierarchy, but it's a more focused argument that if resources like land, forests, and water bodies are community owned, women have more of a say in their management. Now, a very interesting study of five tribes that are at different stages of the interface between customary law and the modern legal system notices, and this is by several scholars working with Walter Fernandez, notices that the changes introduced by the modern legal system produces class and stronger patriarchal ethos. The intervention of individual ownership-based laws first turns land without an individual title into state property, and then this prepares the ground for transferring power from the community to a few elite men, who then take control of all decision-making and interpret customary law to their own benefit, thus deepening and entrenching gender and class inequality. It's very interesting to read this work because you can see that these scholars are very worried about saying this. They keep answering a question which they presume will be posed to them, are you against modernization? Oh, that's it, you're against modernization, aren't you? So you can see they're just continuously saying, you know, one is not opposed to modernization, modernization does not mean things, but it also, in this case, we found apologetically, we must tell you, it produced class differences and it deepened gender inequalities. So it's very interesting to see that it's almost like despite themselves, they're forced to recognize what is happening. State policies further strengthen these processes, for example, by giving loans and subsidies for commercial crops only to individual landowning family heads, interpreted as men. Community property-oriented tribes are thus forced to change over to individual title deeds or pattas. For example, among the matrilineal Garo of Meghalaya, the state encouraged rubber plantation and gave subsidies and loans to individual owners, thus forcing them to get pattas. The administration treated men as family heads and consulted them alone in decisions concerning land use and transfer. Today, women continue to inherit land, but men wield more political and social power than in the past. So women's organizations in the Northeast, for example, the Arunachal Pradesh Women's Welfare Society and Naga Mothers Association, when you listen to them talk about property rights for women, they sound very different from, let's say, the kind of arguments that Veena Agarwal would make with reference to personal laws. Because they do push for property rights for women and equality in representative institutions, but they are very clear that the protection afforded by customary laws from land acquisition by the state and private corporations should be maintained. On the other hand, what they argue, what they show us, these women's organizations, is that the male elite are open to transgressing customary laws in order to sell community lands to private corporate interests, and they invoke customary laws only to prevent women from having representation in institutions. At the same time, there are tribes that are bringing about inheritance rights for women. For example, the Paithe Tribal Council in 2004 introduced such provisions. Now, 15 years ago, legal scholar and activist Nandita Haksal had written critically of an initiative by Madhu Kishwar to press for individual rights to property for whole tribal women. That was a very big issue at that time, over community rights. And it was, in fact, at that point seen as a feminist intervention. Madhu Kishwar no longer considers herself to be feminist or part of the women's movement or the secular movement. But this is an earlier, Madhu Kishwar. And she pressed for individual rights to property for whole tribal women. And Nandita Haksal was very critical of this, and not everyone understood what Nandita Haksal was saying. Because she saw that initiative as uncomprehending of the complex community practices that make up tribal understanding of property and its ownership, and urged rather the need for a struggle within tribal communities to evolve new customs that are more egalitarian, rather than forcefully introducing from above individual rights to property. Huxley's argument is all the more relevant today in the context of accelerated land acquisition by the state in the last few years, and now not only for a public purpose but for private capital. The progressive changes in customary laws that tend towards individual rights and now property rights for women must also be seen in the same background that we have discussed at length in the context of reforms in Hindu personal law. So, the question is the property titling agenda. Who or what is it good for? Why is this happening? Now, in June 2010, a news report noted that Peruvian economist Hernando de Soto, hailed as by the newspaper as a poor man's capitalist, had arrived in India to prepare a roadmap. Anything that sounds very celebratory is in quotes. To prepare a roadmap for slum development in the country, helping the UPA government to merge the informal economy in the slums of the country with the formal non-mainstream one. So De Soto in an interview said he was invited by the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry. And if you go to the tagline on the FICCI website, it's industry's voice for policy change. So FICCI invited De Soto to bring about certain changes. He said he was invited by FICCI to give a few conferences and to meet a few people in government that had an interest in the sorts of things I'm talking about. One of the people in government he happened to meet was the Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, who was later to present to the Union Minister for Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation De Soto's two books, so that she could have a better understanding of issues related to urban poverty and slum development. A government official said to a journalist, the group led by De Soto will be providing us with a methodology for changing the face of the informal economy through routes like property titles and land ownerships. Another official clarified, De Soto's approach is essentially based on capitalist economic principles, but our government will try to meld them into our socialist objectives. Mm-hmm. UPA 2, as you know, by 2010, UPA 2 is far left socialist objectives far behind. The news report added, from its briefing presumably, that De Soto's Institute for Liberty and Democracy, a Lima-based non-profit organization, quote, has advised governments in many countries to vest slum dwellers with property rights to maximize the economic use of assets in slums, create organizational forms to increase the productivity of enterprises, and to provide devices to allow entrepreneurs to operate in expanded markets. The De Soto agenda has long been recognized by some scholars as a project of attempting to bring about capitalism globally through sustained state intervention. Timothy Mitchell is one of these scholars who in 2007 pointed out that his two books, The Other Path and The Mystery of Capital, which were presented to Sarita Kumari by Manmohan Singh, became the most widely cited studies of non-Western economic development in a generation, and that the ILD, which carried out the research presented in these books, was called by The Economist the second most influential think tank in the world. So De Soto's argument, based on findings from research in five countries, is that a large... And those who are familiar with De Soto know that it is actually a lament about why has capitalism not succeeded. What is the problem? Why has capitalism not succeeded? So it's very interesting to read the proponent of capitalism saying capitalism has not succeeded, and Marxists behaving as if there is no outside to capital at all. It's very interesting to see this. So De Soto, based on findings from research in five countries, he argues that a large amount of their wealth, the reason why capitalism is not succeeding, is that a large amount of their wealth lies outside the formal economy, trapped in forms that cannot enter the market, and therefore cannot be invested to create further wealth. He calls this dead capital. This wealth consists principally of land and housing, to which most people in non-Western countries have no formal title, registered with the state. Live capital, according to De Soto, is created by transforming the value of material assets into abstract forms, which can then live as an invisible parallel life. This abstract form is credit and capital. So the root is titles to land, you use that for credit, you produce capital. Now, Tim Mitchell points out, using the example of Egypt, one of the countries studied by De Soto, that informal property arrangements have not arisen because of that of migration, because of ignorance of notions of private property, or because the West did not try to export its property system abroad. This is not just some kind of accidental ignorance of most of the world. On the contrary, in the 19th century, Mitchell points out, Ottoman and European rulers in Cairo launched a series of attempts to transform property arrangements into systems based on an absolute right of private ownership. But they failed because in Egypt, farmers were able, Mitchell says, to prevent the complete destruction of livelihoods that absolute property rights entailed, Unlike the victims of property formalization in Europe, where enclosure and other powers of ownership forced millions of people off the land, rural populations in Egypt were able to delay, divert, or limit the introduction of absolute powers of ownership. The position of ordinary Egyptians outside the mechanisms of private property was the outcome of a long, often violent, but ultimately relatively successful objection to undergoing the dispossession inflicted on rural populations of Europe. So this is just an example from Egypt, but it's not that property lies outside because people just don't know and they need the Soto to tell them these property rights. However, Mitchell points out, once the Soto's program was adopted as part of neoliberal reforms in Egypt, ILD drafted legislation was pushed through to that. This is the Peru Institute, helped the Egyptian elite to put draft legislation which was pushed through to bring about a mortgage law, a property titling program, and new rules for licensing small businesses. So you also find at the same time courts and the government altering the laws protecting commercial and residential tenants, freeing property developers from the constraint of rent controls, and so on. So he basically, Mitchell points out that capital was transformed wherever possible into sources of rent rather than productive activity. And the share of manufacturing in the economy declined, non-oil exports fell, and so on. Now, De Soto's program, so when De Soto's program was actually implemented, this is what happened in Egypt. De Soto's program was promoted powerfully by bodies like UNDP's High-Level Commission on Legal Empowerment of the Poor. Now, what happens is that the language, as you can see, is language that is very, very compatible with a certain kind of a left vision. How can it be bad to empower the poor legally? How can it be bad to give property rights to poor people? So, in fact, you will find that this High-Level Commission on Legal Empowerment of the Poor has India is actually in it. In that High-Level Commission, the person who's in it is actually someone, the person from India who's in it was actually someone who is associated with a critique of the neoliberal direction of the UPA, and in this UPA too, he was actually dropped. Arjun Sengupta actually left all kinds, he was no longer part of the government. But at this point, he was. And this High-Level Commission was co-chaired by US Secretary of State, a former Madeleine Albright and Bernardo de Soto, with India as one of the founding members. And it was set up in September 2005, and I said I will come to 2005. This is the time, you will remember, that the amendments to the Hindu Succession Act were being passed with such a puzzling lack of enthusiasm, but nevertheless unanimously, in both houses of the Indian Parliament. Now, I did say I'm a fan of detective fiction. So this is the dog that actually barked. Now, the De Soto agenda involves, says Mitchell, the movement of assets from the outside to the inside of capital. The process advocated by De Soto of property titling and the use of property as collateral bring into being speculation, concentration of wealth, and the accumulation of rents. And of course, the outcome of this process is that land and housing become even less affordable for the poor. It has been argued by other scholars that the widespread continuation of what are called pre-capitalist forms of production, of course, this term is very misleading because it suggests that ideology of pre-capitalism, so they would be better described as non-capitalist forms. But the widespread continuation of what are called pre-capitalist forms of production in agricultural and non-agricultural sectors is what confronts capitalism's onward march. So Adit Nigam, for example, argues that these are actually non-capitalist rather than pre-capitalist forms and represent, I quote, the recalcitrant other of capital and capitalism, that which capitalism must attempt to seize, discipline, control, and subsume. And the transformation to bourgeois private property, therefore, involves and has always involved a violent decimation of all forms of common property and even non-capitalist private property. This is evident from the case of land acquisition in contemporary India and from the current land ordinance 2015 that permits land acquisition for a private entity and exemptions from social impact assessments. One of the proponents of the degrowth movement, Pascal van Grijswissen, draws our attention to the fact that property economics identifies two different potentials in the institution of property. The first is the possession aspect of property, referring to different levels of use rights, while the second potential, the property aspect of property, refers to the possibility of engaging the security associated with the legal property title in a capitalization process, the most elementary one, he says, being the credit relation. So what happens is the property economy expands through capitalization and competition is that the role of property is reinforced, he says, as a central institution of the organization of society. So what is really happening with the Soto-led reforms is this setting up of a property economy in societies which did not, in fact, have this. And this includes the property role. When once the role of property is reinforced, this institutional path dependency is strengthened and further accelerated by the industrial mode of development, which provides unprecedented responses to the particular pressures of property. So what we're actually seeing is that there a certain kind of dispossession, which after all, as Michael Levine points out, is state-sponsored redistribution of land from the poor to the wealthy. It's a very stark and very simple, that is what dispossession is. And it seems that land rights for women and property titles for the poor are the banners that fly before this process of dispossession, leading towards the establishment of a property economy. So I would conclude by saying that from this perspective, the state, the traditional religious community, and the customary community are all equally problematic from the point of view of equitable access to land for women as well as other excluded castes and groups. A truly radical agenda would have to challenge all these factors simultaneously. State-led capitalist enclosures of commons, which is part of what James Petrus calls the new extractivism, private individual land ownership, and gender and caste forms of exclusion from land use. All of this in a context of accelerated decline of agriculture in an era of rampant dispossession. Marcia Andrews, land rights activist in South Africa, has argued that no effective land struggle is possible without breaking up the nuclear family. A feminist agenda, we clearly have to radically rethink our old slogan of land rights for women within an individual-centered capitalist regime of property. And learning from the experience of movements for digital commons and intellectual property commons as the paradigm for the future, work towards producing new forms of commons and anti-ownership, collective use rights in that.
Dr. Menon will field her own questions. It's a wonderful group of people gathered. And then afterwards we'll have a reception just outside. Let me start with too small. Do you see sites or projects where such an the politics that you call for at the end are emerging?
And do you see
sites where what you call for at the end are emerging? And do you see, you mentioned Agarwal a lot, do you see the large school of feminist economics and particularly Agarwal rising to the challenge?
I do see these, for example, when you have listened to land rights activists, I do see very clear statements that against joint protests. In fact, even a workshop at which even the IDWA, the Indo Democratic Women's Association, which is the CPM Women's Wing, which has for long, joint protests has been at the center of the workshop, even IDWA activists said, we're really rethinking what joint protest means in this. So it's definitely being articulated in somewhat counterintuitive ways, because I think we still have to take on board what that means. So we would listen to that and then go back to, so there's no kind of coming together yet. I would really like to know, the very first time I'm actually presenting this work, I would really be very interested in Bina's response to this, because I see her as a very complex scholar. Not sure how she will respond to this. I would like to know, and I would obviously then incorporate that kind of response into this. So that process hasn't, I think, really begun of taking this on board and rethinking.
Going off what that goal that you what you're calling for at the end. Do you think that's like a real? I'm not challenging you. Do you think that's a realistic goal, like for feminism and for land rights, like in the future? Is it tangible? Is there a way to achieve that, like anytime soon?
Is it realistic? So you know what the French student said, right? fed me the line, be realistic, demand the impossible, in 1968, 68-7. Be realistic, demand the impossible. So nothing is realistic. Did you think digital commons was realistic? Did you think that, the challenges to intellectual property? So I think it's realistic. It's a radical agenda. And I also don't expect that there would be one voice with which women's movements all over would speak, because that is not how feminism works. So clearly, there is a kind of feminism which is about bringing women into the modern economy. Those who believe that capitalist transformation is, in fact, good for society, and that's what's going to create wealth and prosperity, will not agree. So I'm clearly not speaking from that kind of feminist position. I'm talking from the point of view of a feminist politics that is anti-capitalist. And which is, in a sense, post-socialist, in the sense that we also recognize that it's not possible to simply produce socialism in some sense anymore. There are obviously new ways of thinking. There are radically new ways in which indigenous people's movements are forcing us to think. So this kind of agenda will have to be gradually built by one strand of the women's movement in alliance with anti-capitalist struggles. So, yeah, it's realistic. Things have happened. We didn't think Occupy would happen. Rights as
the financialized collectivity, if land rights were also kind of financialized in that way, is that a way of thinking against capitalism through capitalism?
So it's an interesting way of thinking about corporate rights as collectives. I'm not sure but I
it's,
would.
It's not collective in the same way. But is there a way to think through against capitalism through capitalism and therefore appropriate its tools?
I think we have, so I would want to think about the first part of what you're saying, whether I would think of it as collective. Right now, I don't. I'm not quite seeing how you're saying that, but I could think about it, because actually I'm thinking suddenly that, the corporation is treated as, and even the corporation is treated as an individual, right, an entity. And a very lovely novel I read recently, which is what Alan Wright says, it's a strange world in which a dolphin is not a person, but a corporate entity is a person. So I'm not sure I would think of it as collective, but I'll think about that. But let me just take the second part of your question, where you say that you're thinking what are the models for collective rights. I mean, clearly there are older models to collective rights. The forest dwellers, for example, had and still have forms of collective rights. Customary rights are still collective rights. So we have before us actually existing instances of collective use rights. So what we need to push, and that's why it's realistic, because they exist. It's not, we don't have to conjure up this idea from nowhere. And so there are models of collective rights. It's not an argument for going back to anything. It is an argument for using these collective rights, as the Forest Rights Act attempted to do, to build new forms of collective use rights as opposed to ownership rights. So collective use rights as opposed to ownership rights, for which we have several models all over the globe. And it doesn't have to be the same model everywhere. It should not be so difficult to even think of. And really, the digital commons and so on, these are the models when you share a document, and think of the ways in which that is prevented. Think of the ways in which sharing has become a crime. It's sharing. It's what people did. This is what marked humans from animals, although I think animals should think very seriously about becoming like, not becoming like humans, but really because these are the communities, right? These are the, this is what marked human communities, and it's the criminalization of collective practices continuously that we have to challenge. So every time you download something illegally, you're actually subverting. And I'm actually completely impressed by the online community. What do these guys get? Who sit and upload things, and you ask any question, how do I do X? And there will be all these people telling you how to do X. What is that? That's actually incredible. So anyone who believes in the Hobbesian man, you know, state of nature argument, or who thinks that the capitalist individual is some natural creature, should just look at these things. There's nothing natural about capitalism. You have to learn to be capitalist, I would say, counter to every natural instinct that you have. This is De Soto's problem. People are not learning to be capitalist. How do you force them to be capitalist? Collective rights, once we start thinking about it, it will be more difficult to implement among us, but easier to, I think, just draw on. Sorry.
No, I'm really compelled by this deep history that you're offering of the kind of paradox between the rights of the individual and sort of good in the family unit. And I'm just wondering, since you came back twice to 2005, is there something particular about 2005 that births this coincidence between the transnational imagination and a particular kind of shift in national intervention? On the one hand, and then what happens in the decades since? Mm. Right, what is it about this particular moment that births this?
I actually don't know. I mean, that is something that I'm thinking about. So I'm really intrigued by the fact that it was unanimously passed. Now, after you say these things, after you say only women with disability and women who cannot be, after saying all that, you don't raise your hand and say, I'm opposed to the bill. And people across the board. So I need to do some more work on that moment. I don't actually get it. Is it something as crap? Is it a party whip across every party which says that you have to vote? Is it something else, some unnameable financial incentive? I don't know. I mean, is it something as crude as a financial incentive? Is it something more complicated like a party whip? What is it that produces that moment between 1956 and in 2005? Identical arguments are being made, but the damn thing gets passed unanimously. And there aren't people who care enough to attend the Rajasabha session. They don't care enough. So I am intrigued. I don't know what. I couldn't actually do the work for that at this stage. But I would like to look at it. I'm not. So I kind of saw a hint in the form setting of the UN High Level Commission for the Legal Empowerment of the Poor. I think that's too easy. I don't think it works like that. I was struck by the fact that it was the same year. So I don't know. That's something I have to look at. It may not be 2005 as such. It could be that decade or something, because you have these other states passing. The states have passed those laws, or some states have already passed such laws. So something around that period. So a more general answer could be the coming in of the De Soto kind of, and you know, by the, that is still UPA 1, but it's very clear that UPA is not the old Congress. There's a clear move towards you know, the dismantling of Nehruvian socialism and all that. So it could just be nothing as exciting as something in 2005 or around it. But I'm intrigued, and I need to look at it more.
Yes, thank you for your very interesting talk. My question was about the very radical land redistribution that happened in Indian occupied Kashmir of 1951. And did it have an effect, if any, on the discussion within the state assemblies of India of property discussion, property rights, and land redistribution?
I don't see directly any discussion in either the First Amendment or in the Hindu Succession Act. I don't see directly any reference to Kashmir, or I can't immediately remember. But you're right to refer to that, because clearly there is a sense of how to be modern. So the interesting thing is that land reforms were always played out within the language of a socialist agenda, including for us for so long, for feminists. So land reforms were seen as a socialist agenda, and in that sense it is, of course, it is land to the tiller. But two kinds of things have emerged. One lesson we learned little earlier than this lesson, which I think we need to learn, which was that land, which would not have been an issue for Kashmir so much, but land to the tiller in many parts of the country, for example, which worked in Warren and in Kerala, actually basically empowered intermediate castes vis-a-vis the landless Dalits. So in fact, Dalits were very badly affected by land reforms. And the other factor is this, that what appears to be socialist and is socialist, because socialism was also about moving away from feudal relations and land to modern industrialization, we see that that's actually something else now. It's not simply socialist in some innocent sense. But I think you're right, and I should take this into account, and this is certainly something I should look at more carefully, what was happening in Kashmir at that time. Yeah, thank you for bringing that.
Some influence on the talk of the Zamindari system, why the Zamindars, who were, I think, disproportionately Muslim, in Yubi, for example, so their dispossession was countered by, hey, in Kashmir, it was the Pandits who were overwhelmingly dispossessed. Because we remember that it was in the early 50s that the largest exodus of the Pandits took place, up to 40% moved in 52 and 51, because they didn't want their land to be taken away.
You know, I wouldn't read this in terms of the religious identity of the Zamindars in either place. I wouldn't read it because this is a it is a certain historical move towards establishing modern regimes of property, and you see that, and it does happen that Muslims are Zamindar in many parts of India, but not everywhere, obviously. And Pandits are in Kashmir, but I think what happens is that there's a particular narrative about religious communities which overwhelms any discussion of South Asia. And we need to recognize counter-narratives where, in fact, religious identity might just well have been not relevant at all, because when you look at other things that are happening, you see that it is actually an attempt to bring about an end to feudal relations in land. So because of the history of these communities who were feudal lords was religiously determined by religious community, but I would hesitate to read it like that. Did you? Maybe I could just take her and then I'll come to the center.
I'm wondering if you've heard of the Gill Tract and other attempts by UC Berkeley to privatize land.
Sorry, could you say that again?
I'm wondering if you've heard of the Gill Tract and attempts by UC Berkeley to privatize land in the commons, and I'm wondering how do you challenge capitalism and privatization when universities are places that we depend upon to have these conversations?
I hadn't heard. So the university's privatizing?
It's a lot of historic farmland in the East Bay, and universities trying to sell a lease to it, basically, to develop it, commercial development, to a corporate grocery store and housing.
Mm-hmm. And is there any resistance from people who's here? So I guess one would have to depend on the resistance. So I thank you for bringing that to my notice. How do you, because it's a university, there might be a little more space to push than if it were a corporation. But we know that universities and corporations now, very thin line, separates private universities from corporations. But this is not even a private university. So is it the state that is there? So see, clearly this is like everyone is doing this. So I obviously don't know enough. But thank you for bringing it to my attention. And I would say that it still, despite everything, the fact that it calls itself a university should give us more space to push it on its own claims and so on. But yeah, but this is what we're facing, you know, everywhere. And I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, obviously it would be backed by the state and all of that. So dispossession is always violent and coercive. It is dispossession. It is a redistribution from the poor to the rich, as my colleague said, Abhishek.
So it seems to me that one of the implications of this very rich talk of yours is to actually suggest to us that an alternative to forms of individual capitalist property rights might come from visions or models or modes of usufruct rights, right, that belong to non-capitalist communities in various parts of the world, and in the Indian case, the tribals are the sort of model for that. But I was also wondering, you invoke Sharia at a certain point, right? And so Sharia is a legal system that also produces individual rights of various kinds, without producing capitalism, necessarily, right? So, I mean, obviously the sort of injunctions against interest, for instance, should make that point. And so I was wondering whether you think Sharia, and this is purely spitballing, as it were, whether you think Sharia itself might be able to provide you with a form of thinking about property rights that are non-capitalist, mm-hmm. right? But that still maintains some of the forms of individual right that people seem to be quite fond of. In many ways.
So that's really thought provoking, and so I would say to begin with that in India, of course, this question is not relevant because what is called the Sharia is basically just Muslim personal law, and there's no other Islamic economy or something going on. But I think it would be very interesting then, and so that's certainly something I would look at, very interesting to look at whether individual rights need necessarily lead to capitalism or not, and possibly, as you're saying, it need not. I'm of course talking about processes in which the idea of individual rights is to produce capitalism, but perhaps Islamic economy and so on gives us a way of thinking about individual rights that may not be capitalism. But what I did find when I started reading on this, and I looked at, began to look at work around Islamic law and the land, what I came across was work which was very keen to say that, look, we in Islamic countries, and good scholarship this is, it's not we, it's about Islamic countries and Islamic law, it is entirely possible to protect women's rights to property and to produce title and to use it for credit. So the work that I saw was, but that's obviously not exhaustive, I've just begun this work. So I think something about Islam and capitalism and that whole body of work is something I should certainly, what is your sense?
I just wanted to say that there would obviously be a literature that would try to harmonize Islam with the most modern forms of capital that you can imagine, right? But there's also the fact that India itself, in let's say the year 1750, for instance, the dominant legal framework was Sharia, right? So you had an economy now that was a sort of manufacturing economy, an agricultural economy, where there were people who had both urban rights and property, but also common shared rights in land and other places, and formally transactions in land and all sorts of economic and other transactions were run through Sharia.
No, that's really fascinating. I would really take that very seriously and see what that could be another resource. You were asking about resources. So one is to look at collective rights and the other is to look at alternative forms of individual rights that are not necessarily capitalist. I think that's very interesting. Thank you. I'll certainly explore that. Yes.
I wonder if you would add into this the Gramsci or thinker, where you have collective responsibilities for repayment of loans as a way to parallel the demand of land property and property rights as collateral for loans. Is there some, if you throw in the fact that we have very successful experiments, particularly in
Like microcredit, you mean, like a microcredit model for land.
Yes, then can you add that into this equation because it gives another, it seems a pivot for the driving property rights is that it gives people property that can be used as collateral for loans.
Yeah, but you see, the point is that the assumption. That is the Lesotho assumption, that property gives you collateral for loans. But if you look at the way the poor live, the whole business of getting them into loans is part of the project. So it requires you to think about property in a new and different way. Property not because you need a roof over your head, but property so that you can use it for something else, for credit and micro. Now, was found when, Tim Mitchell also studies a particular experiment that De Soto's ILD carried out in Peru, which thought that by giving property titles to poor, then all these things would happen, loans And in fact, it didn't happen. So this particular paper is really interesting, how economics makes its world. I've forgotten the first part of it, but part of the title is how economics makes its world. And what we really find is that people who live in communities without property rights have ways of living together and generating wealth and so on, if the state would not continuously make things illegal. So what actually happens is if you take a regular pavement in my local market, I live in a middle class locality, you know, from 5 to 6 newspapers are being sorted there. From 7 to 8 someone comes there and sells tea. From 9 to 10 something else happens there. Flowers are sold for drugs, right? So it doesn't belong to anyone and it's used in many ways. Now, the idea that it has to be closed off and that you need it for loans assumes that loans are somehow in and of themselves meaningful and fruitful. So it's a particular view towards capital. So microfinance, I must say, within, I'm suspicious of microfinance. And not just me, I think there's a lot of thinking from feminists about how microfinance works and what is the point or what is the purpose of microfinance. So I would say that I understand what you're saying, but and that is exactly what DeSoto is saying, that giving them property titles. But I'm just saying that that is part of the agenda of producing a people who learn to be capitalists, who are forced to learn to be capitalists.
Probably have time
yes.
for one more question.
But
I
just thought that
it's
a fascinating so thank you very much. As you were talking, something that occurred to me was an argument that Mike Levien has recently made about how the Nehru era, really up until liberalization, was the dispossession was first and foremost sort of eminent domain. It was big, large-scale stuff.